I change my PowerPoint because it's still on the first page. Okay, and I wanted to acknowledge something that, of course, I thank you for the invitation. I have no conflict of interest, but also that I was a little surprised by this title that I was given, because you, in Brazil, you already know how to manage craniosynostosis. I think the topic is very well known, and you all know already what a craniosynostosis is. So I changed a little bit the title in something more in, I think, a question, more than a question. What are the challenges we are facing, we will face in the management of the craniosynostosis? So what we already know, but I wanted to focus also on what we still need to understand in the management of craniosynostosis. And of course, I wanted to also to dedicate this lecture to Jim Goodrich, who was a friend of all of us and who participated a lot in the world of craniosynostosis, had a very tight link with Brazilian colleagues. So I think it was normal, and I'm sure that also Michelle did it yesterday to show this picture, which was a great moment we had with Michelle with Jim. So, first of all, this management of craniosynostosis is something that is different from treating a single craniosynostotic patient. It's something slightly different, because for the management of craniosynostosis, we need to understand the condition, and we need to tailor the surgery, the best treatment for the patient. And this is different than treating the craniosynostosis, which often is considered like performing an osteotomy, because this is what we learned, this is what we have told, and so we do these osteotomy lines. And this, of course, is something that a first-year resident can do an osteotomy, but this is not the management of craniosynostosis, at least as I understand it. And for me, it's something more large than just doing the osteotomy in the patient. The understanding and the management is goes from understanding the condition, understanding what a craniosynostosis is, understanding what is the problem for the patient. Is it a functional problem? Are we talking about an aesthetic problem? And then once we have understood what the problem is, trying to solve it, and then finally treat the patient. So you all know that in synostosis, especially in complex synostosis or clover leaf, we have a lot of problems. It's not only a synostosis. We have hydrocephalus, we have the problem of cognition, we have the functional problem in terms of vision, of breathing, of feeding, we have problems with Chiari, with the syrinx, and other problems like the syndactyly, problem of growth, other organs that can be affected. And this is, of course, true in the example you see of a clover leaf, in which we have scalpel problem, brain problem, fascial problem, skull base, spine extremities. But this is also the case in a single suture, like in this case, only one suture, but still hydrocephalus, still a Chiari. Or in this other case, very mild alteration of the skull, but still the Chiari, still the syrinx. So this problem of growth of the skull and this proportional with the brain and also the medulla can occur in all the cases of the synostosis. We know already from more than 1 year that we can have extremity anomalies and head anomalies. Since the description of upper describing the feet and hands and the head. And we know now that the explanation is comes from the embryology, from the common origin of the bones at the level of the skull base and of the long bones, and from the neural crest anomalies. So we have an explanation of this, but still it is difficult to assess which one is doing what. Our diagnosis will be of clinical. We recognize the face anomalies, we can recognize the anomalies of the hands, and sometimes other organs are affected, as I mentioned. And the modern tools can help us in defining these anomalies we have at the level of the skull, at the level of the face, and we can differ these different syndromes by these anomalies at the level of the cranial vault and on the face. But this improvement in the diagnostic techniques has a little importance in the clinical practice. Still, we have this clinical diagnosis of the face and extremities, So we didn't go very far from what Cruzon has already described in terms of clinical diagnosis when you remain to the clinic. And we already know from the times of Cruzon, more than 100 years ago, that there is also a genetic background with a risk of heredity cases that are from generation to another. And this is now better understood with the different symptoms that are described, with the different anomalies at the level of the genetic point of view, and also at the level of the different gene that can help us in differential diagnosis. So the main improvement in terms of diagnosis came from the genetic studies. And we know that now that there are several different genes that can be involved in the same pathway, explaining why the phenotype at the end can be similar. And you see here in the middle, for example, Sertoli-Trotzian twist and TCF12 that are linked together and then explain why there can be some similarities between these different syndromes. But again, we need to have this genetic analysis to better define them. So we had a shift from a pure clinical diagnostic tool to the genetic classification at the end of the 19th century with the starting of the understanding of the genetic alteration that were underlying these diseases. And we know better the different growth factors that are involved only in FGFR receptors with the Pfeiffer, Crudson and Lappert. And now we can better understand why some of these cases behave differently. For example, the monostructural sporadic syndromic plagiocephaly is actually related to a mutation in FGFR3, which is one of the most common syndromes with the Meynkie syndrome. This, and of course, this will allow us to better understand all the other problems that these children can have in terms, for example, of hearing. In this other case, it is a monostructural case. It's familiar. We see the face is affected, but only one suture is involved. So we see that there is a great heterogeneity in terms of gene, in terms of alteration of the scar. So we have same gene several phenotypes, same phenotype several genes, and there is no clear correlation, but still it is important to try to understand to better classify this patient. The example I already mentioned, twist and TCF12, like FGFR3, can give unicoronal or biconal synostosis. And why this is important for the clinician, it is because even if they are similar from the phenotypic point of view, from the clinic, from the radiology, they will differ in terms of risk of having a raised ICP. So the functional risk will be different and will be dictated by the underlying genetic condition. The knowledge of the natural history is also important, as you can see in these cases of acanthosis nigricans with the change in the color of the skin due to the mutation of the associated to the syndrome. Again, another example of similar to Crouzon, but it's another mutation with other problem at stake, so the kidney especially. So it's important to recognize in order to have a better management of all the patients. Again, it's not only treating the bone of the skull, but it's treating the patient. Another example with this Carpenter syndrome, and the list of syndromes is very long, so we can have more and more examples. We have the metabolic forms, in which we have hypothyroidism, of course, but also other diseases of the phosphor or calcium metabolism with hypophosphatase, hypophosphatemia, giving different problems to the children and also the synostosis. The ciliopathy, why I stress that is just to remind that in ciliopathies you have also connective tissue, kidney, liver problems. So these children, even if you treat them perfectly well from the craniofacial point of view, they may still have a big problem from their heart, their kidney, sometimes they need a kidney transplantation, and the early recognition of the syndrome is of paramount importance to treat these patients. And one of the first doctors this patient might see is the neurosurgeon because of this, the anomalies of the skull, and it's important that at that point the underlying syndrome is recognized. Again, this is an example, the osteopetrosis, who will need a bone marrow transplantation. So it's important that we recognize the proper problem, not only the coronal closure, but the overall disease in order to treat the child. So the management of synostosis goes beyond opening the coronal suture that is closed, because these children especially will need a bone marrow transplantation. And this is the same from the antenatal point of view, in which nowadays we have faced more and more cases, and we are asked what will be the prognosis, what will be the outcome, what will be the solution for our children. And this is important that we see the overall picture and not only the skull proper. Because we now have a very good correlation between antenatal and postnatal data, so we can give good an idea to the parents of what they will be facing after the child is born. So we have these different type of problems: synostosis, hydrocephalus, vision, Chiari's syrinx. Again, this is all the overall children, a child that we need to take care of. From the neurosurgical point of view, the risk, of course, as you know, is that of having sequelae because of the hydrocephalus, because of the airway obstruction in complex cases, hindbrain herniation, venous hypertension, and the synostosis. And all this will give a raised ICP. We all know when we open the skull of this patient that these signs are evident at the level of the skull with the digital impression, with the dura, also, which is deformed by the pressure that is exerted. And we can see with perfusion studies, with ASL MRIs, that the perfusion of the brain is affected. And when we measure the ICP, we also see that ICP can be increased in all these cases, especially the complex cases. So we have a raised ICP. This is also due to the hydrocephalus, which will develop very rapidly, in some cases postnatally, and especially in case of bilateral lambdoid stenosis. But we don't exactly know why these children have hydrocephalus, because if we take the example of the Mercedes type craniosynostosis, the sagittal and bilambdoid synostosis, the lambdoids by definition are closed, but still there is no hydrocephalus. Even if there is a Chiari, even if the skull is small, even if there is a distortion of the acridocrine, like in a complex synostosis, the hydrocephalus will not develop. So all these parameters I mentioned, which we consider in the complex synostosis as a cause of hydrocephalus, actually are not sufficient. So the pathophysiology of hydrocephalus in complex synostosis is not clearly understood. And we have to try to classify. We consider that one-third is communicating, two-thirds is non-communicating, but still we don't actually know exactly what is going on. That is a problem. We assume things that actually are not true. The problem of not understanding why the hydrocephalus occurs gives us also difficulties in the management. We can wait and see, we can do an ETV, we can put a BP shunt. With the wait and see, of course, will worsen the functional prognosis, will worsen the cranial deformation because of the growth of the ventricles. But also, the average solution is not so easy. If we do an ETV, the anatomy can be distorted, can be difficult from the anatomical point of view, and also because of the age of these children. And we all know that ETV cannot be very efficient in some newborns, and this is the case in which complex synostosis, the hydrocephalus will, the age in which hydrocephalus appears. And of course, there will be high risk of CSF leak because of the pressure. And then when you will do surgery on the vault, problem can also be worse. If we put a VP shunt, there is also the risk of over-drainage, as you all know. The shunt reduces the growth, produces a secondary synostosis when there is an over-drainage, and this is the risk is higher in a craniosynostotic patient, in which we will have a disproportion that will be increased by these overdrainage, like in the example we see, in which there is a collapse of the ventricles, and this will also be detrimental for the patient. To try to reduce this risk of hyperdrainage, the idea is to try to maintain the volume, so we want a shunt that doesn't drain much. This is why flow regulated valve can be useful in this case, or at least some all the shunts that reduce the risk of overdrainage. This is an example of a child with Crouton syndrome. You see the ventricles were already large very early, but they enlarged even more in the first months of life. you see those distent of the tonsils, you see that there is a obstructive also form of hydrocephalus, and then at the end the shunt was needed, and you see from the CT that the shunt already introduced a collapse of the size of the ventricles, but also of the growth of the skull, and you see at the, after the posterior decompression, the importance of having a shunt that doesn't drain too much in order to maintain the gain of volume allowed by the posterior wall decompression. And then there will be some kind of ossification. This is another example of a problem that we can induce in this patient, but overdrained. You see the flatness which is induced by the shunt, and changing the type of shunt, it can allow to better remodel the posterior part of the skull and having a nicer volume. So we have the problem of the cephalus, we have the problem of airways obstruction, of course, more in complex synostosis, with the facial retrusion, with coronal stenosis, with the laryngomalacia also, which occurs, but might need to be treated by a tracheostomy. So we have some cases with no severe obstruction, there is no respiratory distress, and then there is more of aesthetic problem of the facial stenosis, and in other cases the problem of the facial stenosis is important from the ocular point of view by the respiratory distress, and the airway liberation is mandatory. And this is why the airway obstruction needs a multidisciplinary evaluation, so the management of chronic synostosis goes beyond the surgery with the need of tracheostomy or very early facial advancement, which is difficult when the child has poor bone mineralization, of course. The facial advancement has the advantage of protecting the globe, reducing dysmorphia, and improving the breathing, and for all these reasons, and it needs to be performed, but still in the very first month of life there is a limited place. Hindbrain herniation is another big issue in the management of synostosis. As you have seen, not only in complex but also in single suture synostosis it can occur because of the sleep apnea it can give, because of the syringomalacia that can occur, and there are several mechanisms that play a role in this hindbrain herniation. Of course, in synostosis, we have insufficient cranial fossa volume. There is an increased cerebellar volume, probably in some diseases. We have an increased bone thickness. An example is in FHFR-related synostosis, the brain parenchyma is larger. We have abnormal bone thickness in osteopetrosis that I showed you before, fibrous dysplasia. And we can have an abnormal posterior fossa volume in other cases, like in the complex synostosis or in the Mercedes-type synostosis. And you see here that sagittal and bilamdoid synostosis are sufficient to give hindbrain herniation, which is found in 2/3 of the Mercedes beds. So the closure of the posterior fossa seems to be important in terms of the volume and disproportion at that level. Then we have also the problem of the CSF dynamics. We know that hydrocephalus or the distal leak, anyhow, the gradient of pressure at the level of the foramen can play a role for the chiari. We know that hydrocephalus can induce a chiari, and we have also the example that the cure of hydrocephalus with the ATV can solve the problem of the chiari and the syringomalacia. And we know also by the chiari too that the loss of the leakage of CSF and the gradient it gives will give rise to a chiari, and then that we can see antenatally, and then when we do the closure there will be a reverse of this herniation. So we know that the chiari is not something that is static, it's something that is dynamic, and this is also probably something that plays a role in the synostosis. And then we have finally the abnormal skull base and the abnormal foramen magnum that also ought to play a role. And from the animal models, from the study of syndromic patient, we know that the skull base is also abnormal. We have a lot of animal models that allow us to study how things go at the level of the posterior fossa, how it can get crowded, how the CSF spaces reduces, how the anomalies of the bone develop and continue to alter the growth. And so we can understand that this posterior fossa also in humans is altered, and you see that the posterior fossa is abnormal in all these upper Cruzon, Muenke, and Pfeiffer. So even in the mild situation like Muenke syndrome, there is a big alteration of the cranial basis. The alteration is again a dynamic because of the fusion of the synchondrosis that occurs at different times. We earlier than normal, we'll have some modification when we'll evolve with time, and especially in the very young. When we see the normal growth of the foramen magnum in controls, you see that it has a biphasic pattern with a very rapid growth in the first years of life and then quite a steady state. And you see that in Crouzon, the steady state is reached earlier, so there is less growth in terms of time and less growth in terms of volume. And this is found in most of the FHFR-related condition. Like in the Crouzon, Pfeiffer, Appert, again, we have a reduced size of the foramen magnum, and also in Wernicke, which milder form, but still a reduction in size. Of course, it is even worse in achondroplasia, as you can see in the far right. And when we see what are the clinical changes that can occur in this patient, the smaller the foramen is, the higher there is a risk of hydrocephalus. So we see that everything is intricated. The foramen is smaller, there is an hydrocephalus. The hydrocephalus increases the gradient of pressure and probably increases also the evolution of the chiari malformation. But this is not the only reason. Of course, if we take again the discussion about the achondroplasia, in the achondroplasia, the foramen is much smaller, as you can see again, than the other FHFR-related condition. But still, the hydrocephalus alone is very rare. We have a jugular stenosis, which is much more common. We have other problem of resorption CSF, but the cephalus is not so common as it should be if it were only a problem related to the size of the foramen magnum. And you see what we mentioned before, but still, the smaller the area, the higher risk of hemicephalus, but still, this does not explain everything because it's not true for a achondroplastic patient. Things can go very fast. We'll know also this. You see the evolutive, the very early age, 1 day of life, the position of the tonsils and the size of the foramen, and you see 1 month later the hydrocephalus appearing, the chiari worsening. So this is something again to stress that there is a dynamic changes at the level of the cranio-vertebral junction in this patient during their early days. Given at the end a competition for space, there is not enough room, and there is this tonsillary prolapse. At least this is something that this is how we understand it so far, with this proportion of the posterior fossa, this problem of the rapid evolution and differences due to the genetic background. But again, I stress that this is not the only problem. We need a combination of all these factors, because individually each factor alone probably is not sufficient to give all this problem. Again, if we take the example of the Mercedes-Benz synostosis, we have a problem of competition space, we have a problem of a small posterior fossa because of the lambdoid stenosis, we have the chiari, but we will not have the hydrocephalus that we have in a similar anatomical changes that we have in every FHFR-related condition. So the problem is the combination of all these factors, understanding which factor is more important. Foramen stenosis is not necessary to have the problem of the chiari. Lambdoid stenosis is not necessary, but at the same time, we can have this problem even with patent lambdoid stenosis. In this example of X-linked lipophosphatemia, we have a sagittal stenosis in most 2/3 of the cases, chiari malformation 20% of the cases, but still the lambdoid suture are normal in these cases, and as you can see in the image, the foramen magnum is large. And it is a competition of space, but not related to the growth of the lambdoids, not related to problem of hydrocephalus. It's probably due to the bone thickness, but again, these are only speculation. We still need to understand what is going on in these different patients to understand what is the pathophysiology of all these problems. So we have several hypotheses, we have several explanations. One we can exclude is the chronic distal CSF leakage, as in a myelomeningocele, but all the tetral cords, but all the others still might play a role. The consequence of this inbrain herniation is, of course, the problem of the descent of this tonsil. There is a pressure gradient, there is a cranio-cerebellar disproportion, and foramen magnum anomalies. So we have these different mechanisms, different proportion, different timings, and it's important to understand that in order to tailor the treatment that this patient will need according to which is the most important mechanism and which is the timing during the life of this patient. Because we have different techniques, we can have a direct approach or indirect approach. The direct approach would be just open the occipital bone, the posterior arch of C1, and in transsynostosis, Duraplast is not needed differently from a standard so-called Chiari type 1 malformation. This is an example. You see here the descent. You see that there is clearly syringomyelia. We can do a C1 decompression, the laminectomy, large opening, and the syringes will stabilize and little by little solve. The problem of the direct approach in FGFR especially is that we can have abnormal venous drainage. And there is this problem of the veins from the scalp, and even an interruption of those veins can lead to problems. This is something that is well known and regularly described in the literature with cases of problems with these enlarged emissary veins at the level of the scalp, with the severe morbidity and mortality at the time of incision. And you can see from this example that these veins can be very important. And when we measured, like Tatiana did, we had a big number of cases with abnormal venous drainage in Crouzon syndrome. You see that the collateral drainage is always present with anterior marginal emissary mastoid veins that are present. And this is more common in cases with end-brain herniation, as you can see. Again, everything is linked together, and the more severe patients are, the more complex the situation is. And this is not the case in other type of synostosis, it's not the case in syndromic scaphocephaly, in non-syndromic scaphocephaly, or in Apert syndrome. Again, the genetic background might explain some of the differences, but we still don't know why they occur. But we need to avoid them to reduce the morbidity of our surgical procedures. This is why we have also the indirect approach with posterior vault enlargement, which is a more recent technique that has been described, in which we enlarge the posterior part of the skull. You see here in this example of a Mercedes-type craniosynostosis that it allows to reduce the disproportion, a better place for the cerebellum and the tonsils. This is another example. In a metabolic synostosis with the descent, we do a large posterior flap, and then this will help in reducing the problem of the descent of the tonsils. In older children, we can use the distractor. Again, it will allow to reduce the gradient of pressure, reduce the problem of the disproportion, and have maybe an effect on the CSF drainage, but at the end, the result will be a reduction of the tonsil, a reverse of the herniation. And you see that it's very efficient in terms of clinical improvement. It's a little less in terms of radiological improvement because in some cases there will be not this upward shift of the tonsils that we would like to have, but it can occur even if we do a supratorqual flap, which is limited to treat the gradient of pressure over the tent, not solving the problem directly on the posterior fossa. In some cases, we need a combined approach with a vault and posterior vault and posterior fossa decompression, like I did in this case, in which we had both a problem with fundus and the Chiari, and so we decided to go for a brain decompression and posterior fossa decompression with C1 laminectomy, which allowed to solve the fundus and the papilledema and reduce the size of the syrinx little by little, so with a good stabilization. In the combined approach, sometimes we also have the problem of VP shunts, and in this case can be on the way, and there are risks of infection due to these distractors that go through the skin in these cases, and it might be necessary to try to reroute the shunt in order to have the far away from the skin incision and from the risk of infection due to the structure, like in this case, to avoid any kind of problem, infection problem on the valve. So the problem from the neurosurgical point of view are numerous, all of them going at the end to the problem of the raised ICP and the effect on the brain. But the brain itself can be also abnormal. We all know that in Napper syndrome this is particularly true. We have an clear agenesis of corpus callosum in some cases, so there is an evident abnormality that we can see on the MRI, CT, or ultrasounds in fetal ultrasounds. But this is probably also the case with more discrete and subtle alteration in Napper syndrome, but also in some of the single suture synostosis, which might be not so normal in, as the MRI can pretend. So we have skull vault, brain face, skull base, and spine extremities, in the, and I show you in complex synostosis how all these are interrelated and how to try to solve. We have some surgical solution. We can remodel the anterior part of the skull directly with an advancement, or we can put a destruction of the skull and the vault and the face in some cases, or we can do the same posteriorly with a posterior osteotomy, which will, as I showed you before, increase the size of the skull, or doing a destruction posteriorly or posterior anterior, or we can add other type of hardware like springs posteriorly to increase the size of the skull to allow to have a better volume for the brain and cerebellum. All the goals of this surgery are the same. We want to limit the impairment due to the increased intracranial pressure, and we want to try to restore the form and the function with the least number of operations. So we have seen a trend in the years to shifting from linear craniotomies to very large craniectomies to a stage correction, for especially in complex synostosis. We have seen that going to very early subtotal craniectomies or even total craniectomies would lead to poor results compared to having stage release with different surgeries, repeated surgery. And more, the first line treatment will be an early posterior vault release in order to have a large expansion to solve the problem of the ICP. So nowadays, this is the first surgical procedure with these complex cases. Of course, there are some limitations because we cannot use many hardware in these patients because of the bone thickness and the skin erosion and the risk and the patient laying on the back, that the effect of this vault decompression will be very limited. So there are a lot of limitations, but still, more and more, the first step will be posterior, leaving the anterior part for later on, and then even later treating the face and the maxilla. For the results of all these procedures, we still have heterogeneous results. We have morbidity and mortality, especially in the complex cases. We have higher rate in, for complex and for cloverleaf, for example, compared to single suture, and we have also poor neurological and aesthetic outcomes, especially in Napper syndrome. And when we see our results with these, even with these staged techniques, we see that there are still low IQ results, so low functional results in some lots of apparts, as you can see, but also in some Crouzon and some Setter-Chotzen. So again, the understanding of the underlying condition is fundamental in terms of prognosis. We still, the cloverleaf is a good example with a very heterogeneous condition, very poor outcome. And again, the treatment should be tailored, taking into account the type of malformation that the child presents. There is high mortality in cloverleaf, we all know, because of the associated malformation, because of the surgical risk of hemorrhage, because of the respiratory distress. So the morbidity is high, already at the scalp incision, as we mentioned. But even in these cases, the idea is to have a stage opening with restoring the volume with anterior-posterior increases, repairing the deformity, and try to impair the CSF circulation. In complex synostosis, then, of course, as you know, there will be several other actors playing a role, with the ENT, the maxillofacial surgeon, the ophthalmology surgeon. All these surgeons will intervene to treat the other problems that this patient will present during their childhood. So we need a multidisciplinary management, so it's not only neurosurgeon and it's also a stage. So there is a big collaboration that we need in all these different colleagues to treat this patient. In this single suture synostosis, the evolution was not exactly the same. It was not so linear as we have seen for the complex one, in which we moved to small, to big, and to then stage surgery. We are going back and forth from suturectomies and cranial wall remodeling. So there's a more circular story than a linear one. We had an improvement in the single synostosis, again, in the understanding of genetics. We move to minimally invasive. We want to use distraction in some cases. We want to use endoscopy. We want to use spring, like people you can use in the scaphocephaly. But at the end, the goals of the surgery remain the same. We want to avoid the cerebral compression. We want to avoid the dysmorphia. We want to counteract the progression, the evolution. But we also want to achieve the better neuropsychological outcome. And this is something that sometimes neurosurgeons tend to forget, because we sometimes think that the osteotomy is the solution. But is it really the case? When we see the results of what we're doing, this is the series from Renier on the 40 ans malade of 15 years ago, we see that despite all these good techniques, the results can still be poor. And we know all of us, having done some cases, but we have all of us some poor results with scaphocephaly or for plagiocephaly, just to give two examples of unisutural synostosis, both from an aesthetical point of view and from the functional point of view. So are we talking about different patients? Why do we have these poor results? Is this because of the background? Of course, we know that some just one suture can hide a complex, like in this case, like in this example. This is a scaphocephalic patient, but actually it's a Crouzon with FGFR2. And the time will explain the failure of a procedure for a scaphocephaly. Or sometimes we can have poor results because there is a chromosome abnormalities and the brain is underdeveloped. And the list of genes that are involved is getting longer and longer. So some of the explanation can effectively be because these genes that interact in the growth of the skull are altered, and they alter also the brain, the results will be poor or the recurrence will be high. So yes, there are different patients, but there is also the discussion of are we analyzing these patients. So if we take, for example, scaphocephaly, we see that there are different shapes in the scaphocephalic patient, different angles, different sizes, as you can see in this example. All different CSF spaces, different size of the ventricles. So all these differences probably are to be understood and can explain partially at least our differences in terms of results. So we're probably mixing all the patients together. We consider that scaphocephaly is a single entity, but which is not. The same for plagiocephaly. Probably there are different subtypes of scaphocephaly, plagiocephalies, trigonocephalies that explain why we, in some cases, we have different results from the functional point of view and aesthetic point of view. But also the choice of the technique. We tend to use always the same technique for the same type of synostosis, but probably this is not also the good solution. And when we compare the different techniques, and we take studies that compare the different techniques, you see that we have an effect of age, which gives us the information that we can modify the neuropsychological outcomes just by choosing the right timing for surgery. But when we see the type of surgery, we see also that there are different outcomes in terms of IQ, for example, when we compare different techniques. The type of surgery seems to have also an impact. As far as this study is concerned, the cranial wall remodeling had a better result than endoscopy. And this is another study which goes in the same direction. This is a group from Rotterdam. They study patients with scaphocephaly. They operated with extended strip craniectomies, and finally they found that 10% developed papilledema in the postoperative period. And 10% is not so far from the 15% of raised ICP that Renier measured before surgery. So the question is, are we really changing the natural history of the disease with this technique? And when they tried to study the patient using springs, they saw that the postoperative papilledema rates had decreases in their spring series. So the question is our spring better than the extended strip craniectomy they were using? But we can also ask, is extended strip craniectomy changing something from the natural history of the scaphocephaly from the ICP point of view? But nevertheless, we can conclude that type of surgery has an impact on the outcome. So it's very important that we understand which surgery the patient deserves, because probably we are comparing different techniques and different patients. And all of this makes our mixing apples and oranges and the conclusion are difficult to be definite. There is not only one scaphocephaly, there is not only one plagio, there is not only one trigon. We're talking about different types of synostosis and again different patients. And we still, and this is the big challenge for us, and no clue on the indication on these synostosis, and we have no clue on the functional results. Because with not knowing how we have to analyze, we cannot have the good indication for surgery. So this is another example to see how things are complex, even if we think they are easy. Trigonocephaly, 8% of them will develop a raised ICP, so the rate is very low, but still we do surgery in our patient. And this is a child who came to my clinic with trigonocephaly. There is a light hypotelorism, and there is a crest that of course on the picture is always a little difficult to assess. And discussed the parents with the risk of ICP and all the things that we usually discuss. And then the parents said, oh, but I had the same thing when I was young. And I said, well, maybe you had a crest. I don't think you really had a metopic synostosis. I said, yes, I was the same. It was even worse. Are you sure? Because you don't seem, your forehead looks normal. And then he brought me the picture when he was born. So this is the father at the time he was baptized. And you can see that he had a nice metopic synostosis as his daughter has now, even worse, but still nothing, and it was of course not operated on. So probably we don't know exactly what the natural history of all of these conditions are. And we know that there'll be an increase in the incidence of metopic synostosis, but this incidence was, when we see the numbers, started 30 years ago. So now we should have had adults with trigonocephaly, unoperated trigonocephaly around. If this increase was so important in all the part of the world, we should have seen patients with strange forehead, which is not the case. So either we operate them all, either there is a normal evolution and normalization of the forehead in trigonocephaly, and this should question us on what indication in this case is. So to understand the indication, we need to have an idea of the outcome and compare the outcome with the natural history and the outcome of the surgical series. But we don't have very good outcome criteria. This is the problem we need to solve. When we consider how we can evaluate our patient, we have, of course, functional elements, ICP, fundus, IQ, other neuropsychological tests or functional imaging to see if there is a distortion of the brain. But what we use in most of the papers are just aesthetical criteria. How is the scar? How is the cranial index? How the patient is judged by the surgeon or by his parents? Or we have a surgical criteria. How long was the surgery? Was the patient transfused? There was morbidity and mortality? Or even, for me, worst criteria, like the length of hospital stay, how many days it remained in the hospital, how much it cost. So most of the papers nowadays only stress on these aesthetical or strictly surgical or administrative aspects of the outcome. And if we can use this, the best technique for cranial synostosis will be helmets without any surgery. If we put an helmet, and this has been tried in non-operative scapho, we can improve the cranial index, we can improve the size and the shape of the head. And of course, there will be no scar, no surgery, no transfusion, no morbidity, no mortality, no stay in the hospital. So from this point of view, the best solution will be the helmet. But of course, in a synostosis, putting an helmet, it will be even worse from a functional point of view. So it's essential as neurosurgeon that we remember that we need to protect the brain and we need to have outcome criteria focusing on the brain, not on the aesthetic part. So we need to develop good surgical evaluation tools in the next future in order to improve our management of the synostosis. Because if we want to resume the history of the craniofacial surgery, we start in the 19th with Langlong, with Virchow, describing the different shapes and the different anomalies. And then the surgery and the anesthesiological techniques improved. And this allowed pioneers like Tessier and Guillot to develop complex surgery. And because they were able to do things, they developed the indication. So the indication followed the solution, which was the technique that was developed before even the problem was actually understood. Now we focus on the mortality and the morbidity. We know better how to reduce the morbidity of our procedures. But at the same time, we had also an improvement in the genetics in general in the understanding of the underlying condition. But where are we going for the 21st century? And I think what is essential is that we start to evaluate what we are doing, to start to see why we are doing this, not only how we do it. My technique is better than yours, of course, but why I use my technique and why I do that and why I expect those results. So the indications must be discussed. So our challenge is improvement in the understanding of the pathophysiology, improvement in understanding of our results, to compare the different results, compare the different patients, and to tailor the indication, to tailor the technique to the single patient, not only to a single type of synostosis. So we have to refrain from operating them all. There are probably a thousand of patients that have been operated unnecessarily, but we have to understand which one really need to be operated on. And then we have to refrain to use the same technique for all the same synostosis. Probably we need to have a large spectrum of techniques to adapt to every type of scaphocephaly, every type of trigonocephaly, every type of plagiocephaly, in order to have the better treatment and the better outcome in the single patient. Of course, as you understood, it's a lifelong commitment. We need to follow this patient at least for 10, 15, or 20 years to understand what our results will be. We need a large multidisciplinary team in order to treat this patient, to manage this patient correctly. But the neurosurgeon must remain the leader of this team. It's a neurosurgical issue, it's a neurosurgical problem, and we should not forget that it's the brain we want to protect, and the brain should be our goal. Protect the brain should be our goal. So I thank you for the attention.